The Supreme Court, in a ruling on April 3, upheld the amnesty granted to former Senator Antonio Trillanes IV. By doing so, the Supreme Court contradicted former President Rodrigo Duterte, who signed the proclamation that revoked Trillanes' amnesty. I am Jairo Bulyedo, and for this episode of Rappler Talk, we have Senator Antonio Trillanes IV to discuss his first major win at the Supreme Court. Hi, sir. Welcome to Rappler Talk.
Hi, Jairo, and thanks for inviting me here in Rappler.
Yeah, sir, first things first, yesterday the Supreme Court, after their session in Baguio, their summer session in Baguio, publicized po yung kanilang ruling siding with you in your amnesty case. Did you expect or hope for a positive ruling given that Duterte is a powerful man and we saw how he used his power to crack down his critics during his presidency? Did you expect this at all?
In a way, we expected it because the issues are very basic. The legal issues here are can be resolved by a law student kasi very brazen yung mga violations na ginawa. And my lawyers din, ano, sila Attorney Robles and other experts na kinonsult namin dito were very confident of an eventual Supreme Court win. However, we were not expecting that win to come during the Duterte administration because iba kasi yung atmosphere noon. Ano? Duterte really had a stranglehold over the different democratic institutions and he was weaponizing these institutions against critics and the members of the opposition. Yan nga, no? Isang victim na dyan is Rappler mismo, si Senator Laila De Lima, and the others. And they used that, ano, to have a chilling effect then sa lipunan. And which made this Supreme Court ruling very, very significant. No? Of course, we're very grateful to the justices for seeing the light and standing up for what is right.
Yeah. Na-mention mo na rin, sir, but just to zoom in on that matter, you've mentioned the cases of former Senator Laila De Lima and we saw how the presidential term of Duterte was used to file the cases against her. And after the time, or after Duterte's term, we saw how the courts, one by one, dropped the cases against De Lima and even the witnesses recanting against her. Just to zoom in on the point that you mentioned, did you think, sir, is it safe to say that talagang hindi niyo inexpecto under a Duterte presidency?
Yes. We didn't expect that. Kasi nakita namin kung gaano ang takot, ano, ng judikatura at that time, even Senado, Kongreso, even media, no? They were cowed into submission. And yun na nga, yung mga very few na natitindig, no? Talagang kakasuhan. So that's what happened. Kaya nga it's a refreshing change itong nangyari under this Marcos administration, which is ironic for some, no? Given the historical context, na nare-restore yung democratic space at yung democratic institutions natin are slowly being rebuilt. And in this case, the judiciary ay nagiging independent na ulit, no? Kasi wala nang pressure from the executive, the president, to influence the judiciary so that they can be weaponized against its enemies. So nawala na yun ngayon so far, no? And we're very happy that that is the case.
Yeah. This ruling, sir, is very historical because in one session, the Supreme Court contradicted Duterte's two orders, not just one, but two orders. Aside from siding with you, the Supreme Court also struck down the IRR that was published by the Duterte administration in terms of the GCTA issue back in 2019. So in general sense, sir, what does it say about our justice system and rule of law given the fact that the Supreme Court finally contradicted a Duterte order and it just so happened that it's your case?
Well, ganito po, no? Kaya nga, it's very significant. Of course, I'm very grateful na sa akin nangyari to. But more than this particular case, ano siya eh, precedent setting siya at magiging part na siya ng jurisprudence moving forward na nailagay sa lugar yung pag-aabuso ng isang presidente. No, na na-proteksyon na natin yung Bill of Rights, yung ating konstitusyon, para na yun, hindi na pwede in the future may gagawa ulit niyan kasi meron ka ng ano, jurisprudence, eh, di ba? Kaya this is very significant in that regard. No? And to think that most of these justices are actually appointees of Mr. Duterte. So what it shows is pagka hindi mo i-influensyahan ang judikatura, they will decide on merits. So pagka on merits yan, eh, yung tama ang mananaig dapat all the time. Magkakaroon lang naman ng ano yan, pagbabago ng ganyang pananaw pagka may mga external influences. Diba, kunyari may third party na magbabribe, diba? Or yun nga, yung external pressure coming from people in power. But as it is, nakita natin, ano siya, it will work properly.
Yeah, very interesting, sir. Sir, now punta tayo doon sa naging decision ng Supreme Court. Himay-himayin natin yung mga wording because it's also an interesting decision and ruling because the words are strongly worded. The remarks of Associate Justice Maria Filomena Singh are strongly worded. In fact, she mentioned that the revocation of your amnesty without prior notice violated your constitutional right to due process. And sinabi niya rin na yung proclamation ni Duterte ay nag-violate nung right mo against ex post facto laws and double jeopardy. Ano naging reaction niyo dito, sir, nung nabasa niyo po ito coming from the SC decision?
Well, ano nga tayo, no? We're very happy na ganun din yung wordings niya, walang ambiguity, no? But sinasabi ko nga, when these things were being discussed by my lawyers early on, nung back in 2018, talagang nakikita nila yung mga brazen violations of the Constitution nung ginawa nila Duterte ito nun sa akin. And they're very confident na under a fair environment, lalabas yung totoo at magsasabi, kahit na law student daw, makikita yung kamalian dito sa ginawa nila. And I'm glad na talagang pinanindigan ng Korte Suprema ito. Yung mga ano, no, yung pagbawi ng amnesty then significant yan kasi we are using the amnesty as a tool for peace, no, para makapag ano tayo, negotiate tayo ng maayos do sa iba't ibang grupo na umaklas sa estado. So yan, pagka na-violate yung sanctity ng amnesty, eh mahirap ka na rin pagkatiwalaan nung makaka-negotiate mo someday, di ba? Kasi sasabihin, pwede palang nababawi yan, ano? So yun, these are very significant things that were considered. And for that matter, yun ang naging effect ng decision itong Korte Suprema.
Yeah, and this comes at a very important time for the Marcos administration as well because there's an ongoing peace talks. There's ongoing peace talks with, you know, the other forces in the society that the Marcos government tries to mend with. Now, sir, just last thing on the decision. Meron ding sobrang importante at striking talaga na wordings yung ruling. Sinabi dito na the decision reaffirms that neither the government nor any of its officials, including the president, are above the law. Any reaction on this, sir?
Yun na nga. Alam mo, natuwa ako dun nung nabasa ko yung part na yun. Kasi unang-una, hindi naman siya necessary or essential element dun sa decision per se. But kailangan nilang sabihin yun. Kasi alam nilang this is a clear demonstration of abuse of power by the executive branch, particularly the president, at itong kanyang mga legal advisors, no? Mga abogado ito, yun ang sinasabi nila, na hindi nyo pwedeng isagasa lang dito tapos you expect na on the mere intimidation effect ay ano na, you can have your way. Hindi pa rin. Kailangan nyo pa rin sumunod sa batas kasi yun yung sinampaan nyo. Kaya itong, yun yan, sinasabi natin dito sa decision na to, nilagay sa lugar yung presidente na abusado. Kaya para hindi na pamarisan to in the future.
Yeah. For our viewers who just tuned in, we're talking about the amnesty of former Senator Antonio Trillanes that was granted by late former President Ninoy Aquino. And when Duterte came into power, he actually revoked it through his proclamation. But the DND and others, offices of the government said that Senator Trillanes, in fact, filed his application for amnesty. Sir, let's just relieve and recap the struggles that you've been through. During at the height of this revocation in 2019, you were a sitting senator and this revocation happened at the height of your critics against the Duterte government. After former Senator De Lima was jailed, he went after you and through the amnesty that was granted to you by former President Ninoy Aquino. Sir, pwede po bang parecall sa amin how hard it was to experience all of this?
Actually, nung araw na nilabas yan, I was meeting with the members of the opposition at the office of the Vice President. Nandoon si Vice President Lenny Robredo. And it was, in fact, the Chief of Staff of VP Lenny who gave the copy of the revocation of the amnesty sa isang major news publication. So, sinabing ganun, i-revoke. Tapos may order yun eh. He ordered the AFP and PNP to have me arrested, no? Talagang ganun ka specific. Ang problema ko noon kasi, andun ako sa Quezon City and I had a hearing para doon sa four piece law, no? That Senator Laila Dilipa requested na-sponsor ko, no? Kaya nagkandak pa kami ng hearing noon for the four piece law. Sabi ko after na lang noon ko arrestuhin nila ako, di yun na lang after. So we were there, no, sa hearing. Tapos the PNP officers attempted to enter the Senate premises. Tapos sinasabihan ako ni Senator Riza, who was with me doon sa hearing, na nadyadyan na yung taga PNP. And then sinabi niya na hindi pinapasok ni then Senate President Tito Soto, no. So doon mo makikita na yung Senate at the time, regardless of the perception na parang co-opted siya by Duterte, alam nila yung institutional limits, no, na so hindi nila pinapasok, and that saved me, no. So, and that was the sole decision of Senator Tito Soto. Then after that we spoke, sinabi ni Senator Frank Dirilon sa akin, you cannot voluntarily turn yourself in, otherwise hindi mo na maki-question yung warrantless arrest, no? So ganun daw yon. Di nagkaroon na ngayon ng siege. Then ang isa nakakatuwa nung panahon na yon, regardless of the public perception na karamihan nun kaalyado ni Duterte, pero we were unanimous in supporting my case na hindi pwede kong arrestuhin without a warrant. Kaya yun ang naging decision to protect me doon sa Senado at the time. Tapos isa ring magandang nangyari dito, the AFP, regardless of the order, the explicit order of Mr. Duterte to have me arrested at sa court martial, hindi ginawa ito ng AFP leadership kasi yung mga mid-ranking officers and some senior officers nagsasabi na hindi pwedeng walang ganyan. Kumbaga walang ganyanan. Huwag idadrag yung AFP as an institution dito sa political battles ng kanilang commander-in-chief, no? So hindi siya sinunod. Yun yung doon. Then yung PNP, nung pinalabas sila ng Senate Sergeant at Arms sa Senate premises, they were just there outside. So, kumbaga, some key institutions held kahit na alam nila na mali na yung utos, ay dahil alam nila na mali yung utos ng kanilang commander-in-chief.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, nabanggit mo na rin, sir, but speaking of institutional value, your case is actually a test case for other military and soldiers as well, because kung titingnan natin mabuti yung naging reasoning ng Duterte administration, they said that you did not file your amnesty application, but when other institutions look into the problem, hindi din makita yung ibang amnesty applications of the rest. So parang naging cherry picking siya na ikaw lang talaga yung in-attack, and it could also affect the other institutions like the military as well. Correct, sir?
Yes, and now that you mentioned it, makita rin natin na regardless, kahit na gigil na gigil na yung commander-in-chief nila sa akin at nailabas na nila yung intention na gusto kong ipakulong. Pero nung pinatawag isa-isa yung mga key AFP officers na involved yung sa amnesty, processing ng amnesty ko, sinabi pa rin nila yung totoo. Sinabi nila na nag-apply ako, at on the basis of that application, nag-grant sila ng amnesty. Kumaga, hindi sila na nadala dun sa maling order ni Duterte. And doon, kung maalala ninyo, when Duterte came back from his foreign trip, yun, nagmamaktol siya, bakit daw hindi siya sinunod ng AFP, dinoble daw niya yung sweldo, at kung ano-ano ang panunubat na binigay niya. Pero doon mo makita na kahit papaano yung professionalism of the AFP held at that critical moment na it was being tested. So it's a very significant thing.
Yeah, and moving forward, the public now, especially your supporters, are waiting if you're going to file or seek damages for what you've gone through in 2019, or maybe file a criminal complaint against Duterte. What are your future plans, former senator, on this matter, specifically that you secured a major win at the Supreme Court? Do you plan to go after Duterte?
Okay, pinag-aaralan po ng mga abogado namin kung ano yung mga pwede namin gawin. At kung meron mang gagawin about this, hindi ito born out of vindictiveness, no, pang bebenga, kasi that's not our style. Kung maggagawa man kami, magpapile man kami ng kung ano ng case, is para magtanda yung mga gumawa nito, para may accountability, na hindi kayo pwedeng gagawa ng mga ganitong bagay na abusuhin yung inyong kapangyarihan to oppress people. So gagamitin natin ito para magmarka sa isip ng mga potential na mga abusado na gobyerno na you cannot do that. You will be made to pay at some point.
Opo. And sir, for our last question, looking at the bigger picture now, do you think this is a temporary victory for you? Because if we're gonna look at the presidential surveys, there's a possibility that another Duterte might be, you know, might take the presidential post in 2028, a few years from now. Do you think if that happens, things will be different again for you, especially that you're really one of the most critical, most vocal critics of former President Duterte?
Most definitely. It's going to be a resumption of that six-year nightmare of the Duterte administration. At probably hindi lang sa akin, pati sa inyo, sa Rappler. So it's going to be a nightmare for the people in the sectors and the organizations who advocate for strong democracies. No? Kasi ang Dutertes, talagang anti-democracy sila. Gusto nila yung hari, gusto mga hari o reyna sila. Kaya hindi na, pagka nalalagay sila sa lugar or hindi nila nakukuha yung gusto nila, eh nawawala sila sa wisyo. Kaya sana naman hindi mangyari yung nightmare na yan, yung pangungot na yan. Kaya we have time, 2024 pa lang ngayon, 2028 pa yung susunod, na talagang palakasin yung mga kandidatong kailangan natin na ilagay sa Malacanang sa 2020.
Yeah. Thank you so much for your time, former Senator Antonio Trillanes.
Maraming salamat sa inyo, Mr. Jairo.
For our viewers, if you want to continue discussion and you have something to add to our conversation, you can download the Rappler app, available at Play Store, and then you can chat sa Justice channel natin. We can talk there and discuss what we've discussed here in our Rappler Talk. Thank you for watching this episode of Rappler Talk. I am Jairo Bulyedo.